asked me to give these two presentations. Before I talk about the health services structure in Oman, first thing, I need to congratulate you all for being chosen to this course. So once you are chosen for a course, that you have been chosen from certain group of people, and you are selected for some job, with that there is a responsibility which lies on your shoulder. So once you are chosen, there is a certain responsibility lies on your shoulder, and so you have to be fit for that responsibility. That is one part. Second part is genetic counseling, or the course related to genetic counseling is probably, I feel, is the future clinics in Oman. And because you have to play a very important role as regard thinking about the future generation of Oman. When I talk to some of my young colleagues, I just don't view about the service being provided today to the people. I think about the generation next 15, 20, 30 years from now. So that all these children, our future generation in Oman, they should be healthy. Okay, coming on to the service structure, most of you must have enjoyed some time or other the services in different health facilities being provided by the Ministry of Health. So we'll just go through this. Now coming about the introduction about me, I'll call myself, I'm a health worker. I'm not a trained geneticist or dysmorphologist, or I have not gone through any course related to genetic counseling. But I developed this interest in last 20-25 years working in Oman. And I still remember sometime when I was a young pediatrician working in North Batna region, sometimes in 84, when I had a few cases with hemophilia, when we had no diagnosis of hemophilia in Oman, I had the opportunity as a young enthusiastic pediatrician to travel myself in a very bumpy road to Rubela Ziab in a small village in near Saham and talk to the old lady to get and to make a tree, which we will discuss later on. So this is very, very important for all of us to think about the future. Now coming on to back, now if you look into this map of Oman, and you can see this is divided into different governorate, and those are 11 governorate in Oman, Muscat, Dhofar, and rest of the thing you know, most of them. Now the Sultanate of Oman has made a remarkable achievement in health services, particularly in the percentage and the speedy reduction in mortality, especially in childhood mortality, and the control of communicable diseases. And this is, we keep on talking this when we talk in different forum about the achievement of healthcare in Oman. And this is just few slides, just to enlighten. And so we need to be proud of working in Oman. Many times, because you must think this should be not a formal session, informal session. We keep on talking about some of the experience. When I travel different parts of the world and somebody sitting there and comes to me, are you working in Oman? Yes. Then he asks certain questions. I can recall about one meeting with a person from Germany who came to me sometime about 15 years before in a conference. Are you working on Oman? Yes. Can you tell me about a polio epidemic in 88? And it was probably the best studied epidemic after Israel in the world. So we keep on, so we must be proud of working in a country which has been endorsed this is recognized in a study the World Health Organization covering in 191 countries and published in the year 2000. The Sultanate of Oman was ranked first in the world for its efficient health system and for effective utilization of available financial resources in health services. Many times when I talk to some of my colleagues, they smile, but this is a real fact. And this has been outed by the Dale, the first country in the world and eighth country in the world as far as the overall health system performance is concerned. And this is what, I do not know whether you are aware about the Ministry of Health, the vision, health vision of 2050, that is sometime about 35 years from now. The Ministry of Health is an attempt to visualize how we would like our health system to be in the future until 2050. Now this is the health vision 2050 from now. And this has been outlined in this. Now coming on to the health service, it is now similar as one of the world advanced nations. So health service in Oman, you can compare with any part of the world, any advanced nation. Oman has invested in large years consistently into health services and sustained that the investment over the up-to-date network of 180 local and district and regional health facilities staffed by over 5,000 health workers providing health care in Oman, citizen as resident. Now coming on to this, the health care system operates in three different levels. One is the effective, high quality primary health care. You'll be surprised to know that in different reports, Oman has been considered as one of the first country as far as the primary health care system is concerned. This is something unique, and I do not know when many of you are aware about the way it operates and how a health primary health care worker works in a primary health center and what different facilities and the records are available there. So provided by the health centers, polyclinics and local hospitals in all the Sultanates, governorate and region. Now you will be surprised that we have included some of the hospital providing the primary health care. Yes, this is important because these hospitals are located in area to provide the services which may be little secondary, but they are considered as the primary care services provider. Now clinics and health centers and dispensaries, there are 192 clinics, health centers and dispensaries, these are all governmental. Apart from that, there are 975 private clinics which also provide the primary health care services. Now this chart is from the vision, health vision 2050, which shows number of the hospitals, number of hospital beds, number of doctor ratio and all that. Now just, I have not gone through different governorate, but just giving an example, anyone here from Muscat region? Yeah. You are from Muscat region. Which area do you stay?
Sea.
Sea, you stay in Sea area. So just an example of the Muscat governorate, in Muscat region, there are three health centers. In Matra, there are 6, Alamarat, 5, Bawshar, 8, Alsib, there are 20 health centers, and Quriyat, there are 5. So in the Muscat governorate, there are 47 health centers and 6 hospitals, and these 6 hospitals are 3 in the Wilaya of Matra, 1 in Amarat, and 1 in Bawshar, and 1 in Quriyat. The primary health centers, number of health centers total are 190 and number of hospitals are 29. Local hospitals are considered among the primary health care institutions. Now the secondary and the tertiary health care, there are 2 health centers, that is Al-Wataya and Bawshar Extended Health Center, though they are clinics and health centers, but since they are providing services like secondary, so they are considered as secondary health care institutions. And there are 29 hospitals. Now the regional hospitals need governance. Now these regional hospitals basically in all definitions are the secondary health care provider. But there are few sub-specialty services are available in piecemeal, so they are providing partial tertiary care in the secondary care hospital, and they are in Sur, Ibra, Nizwa, Hema and all these places. So in all governorate you have these regional hospitals which are responsible to provide the secondary care. Now all these health centers which comes in these governorate, they refer these patients, any patients, to these regional hospitals, and from there if there is a need they may be referred to tertiary care hospitals. Now the example of these local hospitals are like BB Hari Hospital in South Sharqiya region, Saham Hospital in North Batna region, Sinav Hospital in North Sharqiya region, and Behla Hospital in Dakhliya region. Now these are the local hospitals at different wilaya level, but they are providing some of the secondary services as well. Now the tertiary health care. Now tertiary health care is provided majority hospitals in Muscat, Royal Hospital, Khawla Hospital, Al Nahda, which operate national wide referral centers. So these are the national referral center. Al Masarra Hospital is a tertiary care hospital for psychological and nervous disorder, and Sultan Qaboos University Hospital, which comes under the Ministry of Higher Education, is also providing the secondary as well as tertiary care health facilities. Now the Royal Hospital, apart from the Royal Hospital building and different sub-specialties, now the recently these services, National Oncology Center, National Diabetic Endocrinology Metabolic Center, National Genetic Center where we are sitting today, and the National Heart Center. Now these all health centers come under the Royal Hospital. They are not autonomous bodies. They are still under Royal Hospital. Though most of them are operate soon, but they come under the umbrella of Royal Hospital. The Khawla Hospital is a tertiary care center for trauma, a neurological and neuro center for March 16. Recently, a circular has come from the Ministry of Health that neurology department from Royal Hospital has been shifted to the neuro department, to Royal Hospital shifted to Khawla. And so the neuro department and neurosurgical department will form a state-of-the-art center for neurological diseases including stroke and trauma and all that. Now the plastic surgery and orthopedic surgery again is provided in the Khawla Hospital. Apart from that, they have the obstetric services and all that. Now the Al Nahda Hospital is the tertiary care center for ophthalmology, ENT and dermatology. Al Masarra Hospital is the tertiary cancer hospital for psychological and nervous disorder. Apart from that, the in Oman operate extensive in child immunization program against different diseases, and the fact that 98% of the infant are fully immunized and the life expectancy is less than 60 years before, now it is almost 90. Now what is a parent institution? You are from Asib, and where exactly you stay in Asib?
Mawale.
And do you know what is the health center near your house, nearest health center your house?
Mawale Health Center.
So Mawale Health Center is the parent institution. Your good name, please?
Bushra.
So your Mawale Health Center is the parent institution for Sister Bushra and her family there. Now, the Mawale Health Center play a very important role because it is the parent institution for the catchment area of Mawale. So all the household in Mawale area, they will be registered in Mawale Health Center. Now the unique thing which is there in the primary health center of the parent institution, this is the child health card. So any child from Mawale is born, the mother may give birth to this child in Royal Hospital or Dakhliya Hospital or North Batna in Suhar Hospital, and the staff who will issue the child health card to the mother of this mother who comes from Mawale will write the parent institution as Mawale Health Center, and she will give the doctor there wherever they will give the child health card to the mother and will all the entry, and the duplicate card will be sent to the Mawale Health Center, and the staff there will update. You need to, I don't know whether in your course you have any visit to the primary health care center where you need to have a look the records in the primary health care center about the child health register and the antenatal register. So this staff in the Mawale Health Center will update the child health register. The child health register is a unique system in that they have various entries which we cannot discuss at the moment, but that Mawale Health Center has got a number. Each health facility has got a number. So that is not known to the staff or maybe knowing, so they will enter and will ask the mother when she is discharged from Royal Hospital to visit Mawale Health Center so that, and will send the duplicate child health card to the Mawale Health Center where they will update the child health register. In case they need to contact the family, they will contact the family because they on the duplicate card all the entries are there. Just one example, if this mother who gave birth to a baby in Royal Hospital, and the Royal Hospital from there the baby is discharged, but as you are aware that we have the congenital hypothyroidism screening program operates in Oman. All the babies who are born in anywhere, they collect the cord TSH. In case the cord TSH is not collected, whenever the first opportunity the mother reports the baby, they collect the TSH. Now this is a screening program to detect congenital hypothyroidism. We are just discussing an example that this mother who delivered in Royal Hospital give birth to a baby whose cord sample is sent, and after about, mother is discharged after 24 hours, and the lab from the Royal Hospital informed the staff in the postnatal ward, this baby Maryam who cord TSH is more than 40, that is say to be further action to be taken. Since it is more than 40, the protocol is that the TSH and the free T4 should be collected immediately as early as possible, and the baby should be started Altroxin unless we have the second result available. And the baby is already discharged, mother is discharged. So the EPI staff will contact the Mawale Health Center because the parent institution is Mawale, and this is the responsibility of the staff in the Mawale Health Center to contact Maryam that she should come immediately, report to Mawale Health Center as early as possible. If they are not able to contact the mother, they will contact the sheikh or the police or someone to get the child to get. So that is the way, and then here the TSH is collected, free T4 is done, and then is started at Truxor. In case this is detected that the baby, again the repeat test, TSH is more than 40, 50 or 70, whatever it may be, and the free T4 whatever, is started, and then diagnosed as congenital hypothyroidism. So subsequently the subsequent follow-up is done over there. So this is just so that you detect the problem early. In the same way, and this is the immunization card, the latest immunization card. So the mother goes to any health center and she is getting the vaccine. Now if the child is due for immunization, say 29th March, and he or she is from Mawale Health Center, and she has not attended for immunization, and she happened to be traveling, and she got admitted in the Buremi Hospital, going to UAE and admitted in Buremi Hospital. Now the mother is carrying the child health card most of the time the mother, they carry the child health card. The doctor there, they look at the child health card and check that this child was due for immunization on 29th of March, and when the child is discharged on 4th of April from Buremi Hospital, this child should be immunized. No child should go out of any health facility unless the immunization is updated. So that this child will, the Buremi Hospital will give immunization to this baby and inform what is known as the feedback to the Mawale Health Center that this child was due for immunization 29 March, has been given the particular immunization in Buremi Hospital, and the staff in Mawale Health Center, she will update the child health register. So that's the way the system goes. Now similarly, what I mentioned about the child health, similarly goes for the antenatal card. As we know, the maternal and the child health services play a very important role. So these two, in the same way, the mother is being followed up for antenatal care in the health center, and subsequently, according to the doctor there, she assessed the risk and subsequently refer to the different health facility, secondary or the secondary field to the tertiary health care facility. Now this is the latest report of 191 nation in the world, that Oman ranked 142, the basic indicator under 5 mortality rate reported as 9 and infant mortality rate as 8. And this is what this is sometime about 15 years before, the Oman immunization level among the highest world, in the world highest. This is because of the system I have just explained to you about the immunization status. No child should get out of your health facility without the immunization updated. And then between 2006 and 2007, we did a Oman IPV study in collaboration with WHO and Ministry of Health Cuba to find out immune response of fractional dose of inactivated polio vaccine IPV administered intradermally. And second, the child health card on which you see the growth curve, that is following a study which was done in Oman between 1997 to 2003, in which 6 countries was involved: USA, Brazil, Norway, Ghana, and Oman. So Oman health services has played a very important role as far as the developing of the health system in the world. And this was the high WHO praise about Oman healthcare system. And this is what mentioned about the growth curve, and this was the MGR curve. Now recently, in January 2016, Oman has got this particular about the strategic certificate of excellence, Pan Arab Excellence Award, given to the Ministry of Health in Oman. Now why I just mentioned that the health system in Oman is almost comparable to any part of the world? Now this is a child, Al-Yamama, who is getting cared off in PICU in Sur Hospital. Now presently she is around 2 years, 3 months and 10 days. This baby born in Masira Hospital in January 2014, low birth weight and preterm and have had severe birth asphyxia. Subsequently, immediately was transferred to Sur Hospital, was taken care of, had multiple problems, referred to Royal Hospital, and then subsequently discharged, went to Masira. This baby was transferred from Masira 5 times in the helicopter to Sur Hospital, once to Royal Hospital. Presently, last 7 months, she is on gastrostomy tube. She is dependent on ventilator and going well. So this is a unique example when some of the visitors come from outside, that our system is comparable to any part of the world. And this is what I have mentioned about World Bank report, which despite low expenditure per person per year, much lower per capita income other than countries in the world with a similar income level, international agencies has considered Oman health system outcome as remarkable. Now this is about the health system in Oman. If you have any query, please feel free to ask any relevant system related to that. Any query about that? Primary and health, secondary and tertiary, and how it works.
I think in Salalah we get circular, which is saying the health center is supposed not to collect the hormonal test. For that, we are not doing the health center. We are sending back people who missed, like a mother delivered in the house. We have a lot of Yemeni and Somalian, sometimes they deliver in the house. Yeah. We send them back to the host tertiary to do their own. Then we will not get the proper results also with them.
I think
the immunization card, we have a lot of defaulters. It was a big issue last year.
Yes, defaulter about?
Immunization basis.
Immunization.
Most of them was expatriate. They just come in and they go back to their place. We don't know what happened for them. We are not sure about if they are there or not.
Yeah.
The phone they give to us already cut. We could not reach to them. We didn't have a sheikh. We didn't know about the sponsor.
Yeah.
We just only documented and given to the supervisor.
Okay. Now, about the immunization thing, much of the responsibility really lies on us, number one. Number one, because we need to say, I'm working in South Sharqi region and there's a company known as Oman LNG. And Oman LNG, you think of any country that person is working there. Maybe from Uzbekistan to US, Philippines, Brazil and something like that. And all these fellows have their family, Ghana, and every country has its own immunization. They're the basic guidelines from the World Health Organization related to certain 6 or 7 or 8 diseases which are included, and certain countries have their immunization schedule. Oman has its own immunization schedule. As you see, if you look into the immunization schedule of Oman in last 30 years, it keep on changing every 2 years. Now maybe in 2007 it may change a day because at least 2-3 person on which I'm one who keep on asking Dr. Mohammad Husni to include rotavirus vaccine in the immunization schedule of Oman, and then he just give a laugh and tell me, yes, let us see, it is a money problem and all that. So we need to hopefully, inshallah, next 1 or 2 years time, rotavirus vaccine may be included. So this is, I think, much of this now about not collecting the sample at the health center. I think this is probably a local logistic issue about that. So that is, I think.
Well, the cost of that is
sensitive. Yeah, so yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And it's the long time from the patient life. So why small hospitals like UGAD cannot transfer direct to Muscat hospitals? This is point, and at that point, as she said, blood investigation.
No, blood extraction should be. But the referring, because there's certain protocol related to the referral made by the Ministry of Health. Now there are occasions when it is not that every patient from BBLE cannot be transferred to Muscat. Now, thing is that there are occasions when the patient from BBLE are transferred to Royal Hospital, but they are usually after the consultation in Sur Hospital. And most of the time they go, so there's a baby born with heart block. I still remember we can communicate with the team in the Royal Hospital, and the patient goes directly from BBLE Hospital to Royal Hospital. So, but the protocol exists from primary care, they have to come to a secondary care health facilities and secondary to tertiary health care. As you can understand, the Royal Hospital and the University Hospital and the Khawda Hospital are definitely, there is a shortage, particularly the intensive care bed, there is a shortage of bed. If you walk into the A&E in the Royal Hospital, there are lot many patients are in the A&E who are waiting to get a place. Getting a bed is a real problem to get a place in the Royal Hospital. That is because the intensive care bed are short, and the services which are to be provided in the regional hospital are at times provided by the tertiary care hospital.
Sometimes we get a patient from America or other Europe area, they will ask for the rota vaccine. Then we are still within the deal with it. They got shocked when we didn't have a rota vaccine till now. This is our schedule.
Yes.
What we did, because they will stay with us for 2 years, we make them to accept our schedule. We are not following their schedule.
Yes.
This is Oman's schedule.
Yes.
We go, because this is the disease which is available with us.
Yes. That's exactly when these people from different part of the world, they come with the immunization card, what you're telling. I just sit and spend about half an hour or so and adjust the vaccine. It is not difficult to adjust the vaccine. All the vaccine can be adjusted. And some of them, if they are really interested to get any other vaccine which is not in immunization schedule. So now varicella is in our immunization schedule. Sometime before it was not there, but the parents were asking, yes, it is available outside. Now today rotavirus vaccine is not in our schedule, but outside is available, and it is quite costly vaccine. Two vaccines are to be given, one vaccine costs about 35 riyal. So two vaccines for a child need about 70 riyal. So that is a
There is some country also, they said the Russia, I think, or French. Then they think they said the vaccine is not must for our children. Once the children is healthy, we don't need to give the vaccine.
I don't know how we can change to other. Do you know how to change to other?
It was a nice lesson. But I fell from the BCV when they are changing all BCV, old BCV 7, BCV 10, and BCV 13.
Can we have somebody to change this?
Nice to meet you, Doctor.
You are taking care for genetic at Sur Hospital, right?
We have genetic counseling clinic, which usually taken care by Sister Aisha, Sister Aisha and Namimi.
Actually, I'm from Jannan.
Yes. Yes.
So that we can start and start genetic OBD in
general. Inshallah, why not?
So which days you are opening your genetic OBD?
No, there is no genetic, it is a just clinic, genetic counseling clinic. Now presently, this counseling clinic, we just talk about three diseases. Now many times the people come with different, at the moment we have the screening only.
This one, the flesh.
One moment. I think the second. How can I go there? With this mouse. No, it is. Yeah. I want to come. It can't come. This is the one. No, here, this is the one.
It's here, outside the valley.
Okay. All right. Yes. Yes.
This is the previous one, the value of
the No. This is still working.
Yes. Eh?
Yes. Can't put it off. Who is the gentleman is not here? Yes. The fellow who is handling this. Many times in a family, if there is any congenital malformation or any disease, they come to us to know whether this disease will be repeated in general. At present, as far as our system is concerned, we are only having the test for sickle cell disease, thalassemia and G6PD deficiency in most of the genetic counseling clinic. So many times when they family comes, we have to explain to them that at the moment we have only these facilities. But we can always have a session, counseling session with them after discussing what problem in the family and what is the child or the somebody's problem. That whatever the test, screen test in the family member available, that we can do. But at the moment, we have only there. Hopefully, inshallah, when you will start in the field, maybe some other facilities will be available to do the test for various diseases. Can we start the second one? Okay. Now, the value of family and genetic pedigree in counseling practice. Now, to draw a pedigree is very important. Now, what I am going to discuss, some vision which I have already discussed, of achievement in Oman, in healthcare in Oman, and what is a pedigree, what is the definition, which uses genetic counseling, how you construct a pedigree, symbols, connecting the symbols, interpreting a pedigree and common inheritance pattern, and some one or two real scenario we will discuss. Now the vision is that all adolescent boys and the girls likely to be engaged or for marriage have their screening result for genetic blood disorders known to them. This is at the moment that what our vision is, that everyone who is going for marriage in next 1 or 2 years should have in his or her pocket about the result of her, whether she has or she has been screening for genetic blood disorders or not. Now the family history, if you look into is a low technology tool when you are drawing, sitting with the family and making a pedigree, is a very simple tool, not a very high-tech molecular test which is done in the National Genetic Center, but really has got a high technology medicine. We'll just go through this, how I can use this particular statement, though this is a very simple technology tool, but is offering a very high technology medicine in a remote area, in Bibi Ali or Bibi Hasan or Wadi Bani Jabir or Sahab. Now, what is a pedigree definition? A medical pedigree is a graphic presentation of a family's health history and genetic relationship, and it has been pivotal role in the practice of medical genetics for nearly a century. Diagram of a family relationship that uses symbol to represent people and lines to present genetic relationship. And pedigree, a family history that shows how a trait is inherited over several generations. Pedigrees are usually used when parents want to know if they are carriers of a particular disorder. Now, how we analyze a pedigree? In human, pedigree analysis is an important tool for studying the inherited diseases. Pedigree analysis uses family trees and information about affected individual to figure out the genetic basis of a disease or trait from its inheritance pattern, predict the risk of disease in future offspring in a family, or genetic counseling. Now, this American Society of Human Genetics defined genetic counseling as communicative process which deals with the human problems associated with the occurrence or risk of occurrence of a genetic disorder in the family. Now, the genetic counseling is a communication process between health care professional trained in genetics and an individual or family, and condition and its risk recurrence, discussing the options available and assist the family in choosing the options. Now, these are the various symbols which I am sure in the basic of your genetic counseling course you must have gone through: the male, female, mating, parent and children, boy and girl, the zygotic ring, monozygotic, health, unspecified, number of children, consanguineous marriage, method of inheriting, abortion, probate, death, and all those. And these are the various symbols, I'm sure. male, affected male, unaffected female, and dead, and all that. Now, these are about the mating, consanguineous marriages, mating, offering, arrow point to the probate. Now, making a pedigree, when you make a pedigree, that female and the male and the married couple as the sibling, you can see that one. Parents, boy and the girl, affected with a disorder, these are the field symbol. Now, example of a pedigree. Now, grandparents, parents, aunts, uncles, brother, and you yourself, if we are making a pedigree. Now, the step one, that is, you suppose this is the probate, then you make a pedigree about this, the first step of the family. Second, adding aunts and uncle, and then adding cousins, then adding grandparents and their cousins. And this is what identifying the individuals in the pedigree. The probate is 3, this is 3, 4, this is the one probate. Then the probate siblings are 3, 5, 3, 6, and 3, then these are the probate siblings. Probate's parents are these one, okay. Now, the aunts and uncles are 2, 1 and 2, 2, these are one, and this is the one. Probate cousins are 3, 1 and like that. Grandparents are 1, 3 and 1, 4, these are one grandparents. and the probands, aunts and uncles are one like that. So you make a dependency. What I was mentioning just before about my traveling to a remote village in when we had a child, boy admitted with us with hemophilia, and we took the history, and the mother told that my grandmother says that she has some brother who died, and she so that the way we would travel and then just make a pedigree of the whole tree of the, and then we were able to locate about some 9 patients with hemophilia. Now coming on to the common inheritance pattern, one is autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, X-linked recessive and multifactorial. We are not going to discuss much about this, but just you all know that autosomal dominant is the one, an affected person usually has at least one affected parents. Affected either sex, transmitted by either sex, and a child on affected parents, an affected male has a 50% chances of being affected. Now this particular example, we see that this is the patient, and then you see that whether this is recessive or dominant. So this is the dominant, the answer is dominant. Now this is, you can see an individualized pedigree of a patient with hypercholesterolemia. You can see that their affected parents are there. Now these are the various examples of dominant trait: achondroplasia, brachydactyly, Crouzon syndrome, familial hypercholesterolemia, and all those. Now autosomal recessive inheritance, affected people are usually born to unaffected parents. Parents of affected people are usually asymptomatic carrier. Now the child who comes out to be with some disease, and when you talk to the family after getting the result, they say, we don't have anyone in our family, and myself and my wife is absolutely fine, and that's what, and affects either sex. And after the birth on affected child, each subsequent child has a 25% chance of being affected. Now this is the example of a pedigree chart of a dominant or recessive. See, now both the parents, but these are the affected family. Now this is, answer is recessive. Now that you, the human traits which are in the single genes, they are albinism, sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, and galactosemia, and all those things. Now X-linked recessive are the affected, mainly males. Affected males are usually born to unaffected parents. The mother is normal. Now this is X-linked. Now into this you see, this is the one which is there, but this is all is unaffected. Now this is the certain disease like hemophilia A and B and various other diseases which are related to X-linked recessive. Now this is the family tree of the royal family of England. Now because if you look into the various old books which has been printed maybe 40 years before now, the hemophilia was labeled as a royal disease, because in the royal family in the England they were patient with hemophilia. And so, and we can see this is the generation chart of those who are affected, and the carrier female and the hemophilic male. Now this particular pedigree of a family who is being cared, taken care of, and they are from BBLE in Sur Hospital in South Sharqiya region. Now you can see the father he still has refused to get the HPLC done. He comes with his children, but has refused to get the HPLC done. But we have, these are the various patients and the carrier in their family. Now, and this is a family of thalassemia. Now we have another family of thalassemia. This is both the parents, when they had the first child, all these three children are under the care in Sur Hospital, and getting regular blood transfusion and and the chelation. Now when we had this child born and we did the screening, we counseled the family. And explain to them the risk according to that. And when she had the second child and turned out to be a patient, and the third child turned out to be patient, and the fourth child turned out to be a carrier. This is something in a very difficult situation for the family. And this is another child family. Now the real life scenario, I'll just go through about it. Now this is the same family which we are talking about, thalassemia family in South Sharkey region. Now these are the various carrier and some of them who have died and getting, these are the 3, 1, 4, these are the thalassemia patient. Now this is another family, same family, this is thalassemia patient. Now this girl and this from the same family, they were engaged and were going to be get married. Now the, since the launching of the genetic counseling clinic in sometime 2001 until today, we have still not been able to really push the program the way it should be, because ideally every single marriage which is being taking place, before that they should have, the boy and the girl should have their screening done for genetic blood disorder. And that was when the Under Secretary of Ministry of Health launched the program. Every year 20 children are born with thalassemia in Oman, and 120 children are born with sickle cell diseases. Now these are still, so you can think of in last 10 years about 1200 patients with sickle cell disease and 200 patients with thalassemia are added in the, on the burden on the healthcare system. So the important message which I want to give in this today, that we need to counsel, explain to the parents, not only those you come, your relative, your known person, your friends, that they should have the test done. Now when they were engaged and they were almost getting married, now the mother, I tell this story in most of the presentation and just explain. Now this lady, Nawal, who is the sister of this lady, she brought her and brought him and got the test done. They were not willing to come to for the test, but she almost forced them. And once we got the test done, both of them turned out to be carrier. And with great difficulty in the family, it took almost 3 to 5 months with her effort and of course the effort of sister Aisha and all that, it was decided that they should know, because she explained to them the way she, her daughter and other children in her family are suffering. And subsequently we were able to disengage them. And this is the important, most important role which you have to play in the future when we are talking about the establishing genetic counseling services and the clinics in Oman, so that the number of these diseases will drastically will fall. We have all these health education booklet available and which explain about that. Now this is a unique study which we did in South Sharkey region and subsequently we presented this in the 18th International Pediatric Conference and 2nd Pan-Arab Hematology Conference, in which the hemoglobinopathy screening for all class 11 children in Wilaya, Al Kamil and Wafi. And so all the children, students in Wilaya al-Kamil Wafi, they were screamed. And you will not believe, initially when we were trying for this project, everybody was telling, parents will refuse. But out of 475, only two refused. And so we were able to screen all 473 boys and the girls. And subsequently the result was found out, finalized, they were counseled. And this took, and this is the one of the visit of Professor James Ekman, who presented in the one of the lecture which he gave, that 6% of the Manis have sickle cell anemia, 2% have carrier of thalassemia, and 10% population with genetically predisposed and dangerous blood disorder. And this is what we see. Another center of genetics has come up in the university. Now this is the most important part which you are going to play, is health education, health education, health education. And that will play a role in important part in decreasing the number of these patients with the genetic blood disorder. This is the various sessions related before we did that study in Al-Kamil Al-Wafi. And so again, coming on the prevention, prevention, prevention is the only answer of that. Well, that particular slide which I showed to you, in which, going back to the slide, Hamad, who is that? Hamad and his wife. Yes. We gave that booklet which mentioned that if you have four children, the 25% are likely to be diseased, 50% are likely to be carrier, and 25% may be normal. But in this family, that was the situation, the three children turn out to be carrier. So there we use this particular verse from Quran, وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ الْعَظِيمُ, and He is all knower of every creation. Now we need to learn the lesson from countries like Cyprus, like Bahrain, so that if we implement the pre-marital screening, which is the most important preventive method of reducing the number of birth of sickle cell disease and thalassemia, and much reduce the burden on the health resources in Oman. So tomorrow's success, what we are viewing of now next 20-25 years, is all depend on your today's effort. So once you are in the field, you need to play that particular effort so that we continue to serve and get the highest rank in Oman. Now, if you have any question related to about the counseling, about things, I know that probably you have gone through that course, you are but much better informed, but because of my experience in this particular area of child health care, I can just answer few questions. If I cannot, I'll say you need to go through the books. Because we should have the session really informal, and about this is very, very important. And in this, I always mentioned, recently, last week, there was a workshop in Sur where I had to give, they asked me to give two presentations about Down syndrome. And you were there? Okay. So I always give that message. And you can also later on, when you see a child with all features of Down syndrome, or anybody tells you, please, please, never ever use the word, this child has Down syndrome. Why? Because you must use this word only after you are 100% sure and the karyotyping result is in front of you. Once the karyotyping result in front of you, now you must be aware Now the Ministry of Health has started specialized services about screening for Down syndrome. It is in the infancy stage, but hopefully in next 5 years time it will come up so that these patient children with Down syndrome should have a comprehensive health care services and amalgamate themselves in the normal population. And we should have the screening from the beginning. I cannot discuss all those screening steps at different ages or all that. But for you, always use the word, probably this child has some abnormal feature. Or maybe in your documentation, you can write query trisomy. Now, because the parents are well informed today, if you use the word Down syndrome, and this turned out to be not a case of Down syndrome, or before using the karyotyping, the father can ask you, how you know this is Down syndrome? So this is very, so before when you are as a genetic counselor, when you are using the word, or if you are asking somebody for karyotyping, the other day means about some years before, I got a call from the delivery suite. And when I entered the delivery suite outside, the one very important personality in our region was sitting there. He's a doctor. So as soon as I entered there, he asked me, you have been called to see the baby who is born just now? And I said, yes. Why they are asking for your karyotyping? I said, after having the normal conversation, salaam alaikum and all that thing, I think there must be some reason, let me go through. Oh, I think they are asking for the karyotyping because your wife's age is 38. And this is always better to get the karyotyping done if they are certain. Are you going to say it is Down? I said, no, I cannot say. I hope it turned out to be everything normal. But to be on the safer side, if tomorrow you bring the child after, at the age of 10 days and ask me, then why should I put myself in a difficult situation? He agrees. It's what just by chance child has all the features of Down syndrome, karyotyping done, turned out to be Down syndrome, and now being followed up, we have got as per the screening which is done today. We did this in last few years before all those screenings. So it is always better. So whatever you say, your statement is very, very important. Again, don't forget the scenario which I mentioned that only 25% likely to be diseased, and then so how you can come out of this? Science is something, but وَيَخْلُقُوا وَعَلَىٰ تَعْلُمُونَ is the one which you save you at many aspects, very the genetic counselor.